My name is Chris Bintliff, and these are transmissions from Not Really Rocket Science, where we study the technology, techniques, learning, and lifestyle of the modern marketing engine. When we're buying something or considering a purchase of almost any kind of consequence or significance, we do this kind of internal calculus that inevitably leads to this very popular question, is it worth it? Is this thing worth it? By insinuation, we're kind of wondering, is this thing that's more expensive than that other thing worth the increased expense? And the very easy and kind of inaccurate answer to that question is, hey, that depends. What's worth it to me might not be worth it to you. And so that's the kind of feedback that you'll often get on that. But there's actually something a little bit more specific that we can explore to answer that question so that you can actually know with a little more clarity, what is worth it to you? What does that mean? This is true if you're a consumer or even if you're in business to business. There are some things that are predictable if you are honest with yourself about those things that help you to examine what's worth it to you or why you would buy that thing. There are three and kind of a bonus fourth element to this, and we're going to explore those over the next few episodes. But today I want to talk about the first one, which is value. What you value and how it creates a reality around answering this question, why would I buy that? So why know this stuff? Why is it helpful for you to understand with a little bit more accuracy what's going on when you're thinking about, is it worth it? Or why would I buy that thing? Well, a couple reasons. One, the more self-aware you are, the more informed and prepared you can be for making the right decisions for you when it comes to buying something. Two, however, you can be sure that the smart brands and the smart companies and the smart products that are put out there have spent a lot of time thinking about this question, is it worth it? Why would this person buy this thing? They have personas and avatars built up all around aspects and characteristics that they think best represent the person who is most likely to buy this thing. You might be, in their minds, one of those types of people. So if you are aware of the same things that they are aware of, it's going to help you at least understand the intentional ways that they are positioning things, those brands and companies that they're positioning things towards you, but also in some cases trying to manipulate you. And if you're aware of these things, then you know kind of what screws they're trying to turn to help you take some behavior that they want you to take by our thing. But also, if you lead or manage or run a business, or if you're a salesperson or you're involved at sales at all and you're not asking some of these questions, then you're kind of going into all these situations blind and you're having to work a lot harder than smarter. So if you haven't thought about some of these questions in your own capacity, it would be valuable to explore some of these things and to see where you would think the answer could be, because it's going to help you to position whatever it is that you're trying to position in a way that's more likely to get a person to take the action you want them to take. Consider buying our thing. Okay, so today we're going to talk about value, what you value. There's three ways to think about what you value: functional, emotional, and social. Functional is the easiest. How does a thing work? What's the utilitarian service? What's the utilitarian purpose that it serves to get me from where I am now to that problem has been solved? Functional is the stuff of features. It is this big. It is this wide. It has this thing that operates on it. It's made of this material. That is the stuff of functional. Emotional is, how does it make us feel to use a thing? Usually it starts with, we're trying to avoid pain and then experience pleasure. So is this thing going to be a hassle to use? Is it going to be time consuming or too complicated or in any way unpleasant for me? Or is this thing going to be really awesome? Is it going to make my life easier? Is it going to be a joy to use? Those are emotional aspects. Social aspects is usually about saving face or gaining status, in that order. So again, we don't want to be embarrassed using this thing. We don't want to be in a place where others look at us differently. And we'd like to be in a place where others, if they are going to look at us differently, they look at us with an escalated perception of ourselves. So social connects to emotional about how other people's perceptions make us feel. So let's break this down. Let's say we're looking for a women's backpack, not like a camping backpack or some big complicated thing, but you know, like an everyday carry. It's got a laptop, it's got some other things in it, whatever. The functional purpose it needs to serve, can it hold some stuff? We can find something like that pretty cheap, $13 at Walmart. There, problem solved. We've checked the box, this is over, let's go on with our day. Well, let's investigate it just a little bit. Maybe it's mass-produced somewhere. Maybe it's made of really inexpensive or cheap materials. Maybe we're a little bit skeptical of the craftsmanship on it. So maybe we do a little bit more research and we say, you know what, I'd really like one that's made out of this thing, leather. I really want one that's handcrafted, that's hand-stitched. I like the idea of it being handmade, not by people in a factory. What I'm actually doing is I'm starting to think about things that are important to my value system, like ethics, like craftsmanship, like longevity, and I'm justifying them from a functional perspective, but really it's about how does it make me feel to use the thing. This is one of the interesting aspects of this that companies and brands know that you might not, which is we consumers put a way higher emphasis on functionality in our minds than what we actually practice. Most of our buying decisions are irrational and they come from our gut or from our heart. Our head is the least interesting place for us. So we will justify doing something different around this idea of, well, it's better functionality. Well, it's gonna last longer. You know, this is a good thing for me to buy. I like the max trim level on the new car that I bought because, you know, it's got the Bluetooth enabled widget that makes the tires fly out when it's bumpy. That's gonna really help me be safer. That might be true, but you just really love the idea of having the thing. It makes you feel cooler, it makes you feel fun. When people come in and see you're like, hey, look at my cool new car. All of those are about feelings, that's emotional. There's nothing wrong with that. For some reason, we're just really averse to being honest about it. And so the functional aspect, least interesting, easily ticked off, but we can then start to explore this emotional aspect. How does it make me feel? Well, then let's say on our backpack, we're looking at that and we're thinking about different backpacks and we decide, you know what would be really great? Let's get this one at Gucci. This is awesome. That's almost entirely about the flex. The materials or the craftsmanship, you can absolutely justify it's made of Italian leather, it's handcrafted, it's this, it's that. It comes from a deep lineage of expertise and that's awesome and that's great. And it creates a feeling for you where you think this is a really high quality item. I really love this. This makes me feel really good to use this. But you absolutely love the flex. You love the idea that everybody else might have a Walmart backpack, but you come walking in with your Gucci backpack. And if you're honest with yourself about that, and not in any way thinking that that's a negative reflection on you or your personality, it helps you to know, look, the reason why I'm considering this Gucci backpack and I'm not even looking at the Walmart backpack is because I'm a person who admires, who enjoys feeling admired. Awesome. If you know that about yourself, then it's going to make it really easy for you to start answering the question, is it worth it? Because you're not going to spend any time on the things that for you aren't worth it. You're going to be able to say functional, I know I'm gonna get that. I know I can haul my backpack, my laptop around in my backpack. I don't need to spend any time with that. Now you're gonna be really in this emotional and social space. Social is about connecting to a sensibility or a feeling that you aspire to. It's why influencer marketing is so huge, right? So somebody that I admire is using some product, I'm automatically going to be more interested in that product or curious about that product without knowing anything about it. The functionality of it isn't even on my mind, but if they like it, maybe it's cool. This is the conventional wisdom. This is why it works predictably, why influencer marketing works, why people and brands spend a lot of money, because it connects somebody that is admired to some product and they hope some of that admiration rubs off on that. Now, there are other ways to think about this. We haven't even talked about your dollar spend. And that's a different conversation we're gonna get into in another episode. But one thing that I wanna point out is what we talked about is kind of consumerism, business to consumer, the feeling of buying a product or thinking about a product. But a lot of these things hold true even if we're in business to business. The functionality of something, it's a piece of software or it's a platform or it's a training that you're gonna be involving your company in or whatever. The functionality of that is supreme. It has significant importance. But when we can think about the person who's making that decision, what do they value? We can start to answer questions around what's really motivating them or driving them. So when I'm doing any kind of work with a client where we're gonna start a project, we start from this place. We don't start thinking about what kind of flashy thing can we build or what kind of shiny thing should we, you know, deliver. We start in the weeds with who are these people? What do we sell? How does it fit with these people? And when we're talking about business, we're often thinking about something that is connected to job security or pay or promotion. And so the reason why I want this transaction to go smoothly, I'm in charge of finding our new CRM and implementing it. Obviously, there's huge impacts to the efficiency and maybe even the bottom line of the company. But as a person who's been put in charge of this, I don't want to screw it up. I don't want to be the one who's looked at as we complicated this or we went over budget. That's going to reflect poorly on me. I really would love that promotion. I really would love the bonus that comes at the end of this. I think I've got a 5-year plan that involves being a vice president, and I know that this project and doing it well is going to get me there. If we know those things, we who are creating the product that's being sold, if we know a little bit about those things about that person, we can use that to our benefit to say, look good in front of your peers. Relax, you're going to have more time because this. You could be off the ground in 3 months with what other value proposition would take you 9 months. And all of that we can do in a way where we can present it from a marketing or from a sales perspective that taps into some of that emotional value or that social value, again, saving face or gaining status. Different thing at work than when we're wearing sneakers. We can tap into those things. I say all the time, emotion is the currency of marketing. A final point on this idea of value is when a brand is presenting features in its marketing, I hope that that's on purpose. I hope that it's to say, we know that you care most about the size and the measurement and the speeds and the feeds and the materials. That is what you care most about. Often, especially with small businesses who are trying to sell a product or position a product, or salespeople who are trying to go in and sell a thing, they will have a misunderstanding of the values of their customers, and they'll lead with the most obvious thing, which is functionality, features, when in fact that's the least interesting thing to the person buying the thing. An interesting way to look at this, we go back to our backpacks, look at Walmart. They're talking about their $13 backpack, and they're doing it with specific bullet points. Literally, how things, what the size is, what it's made of, is it waterproof? Functional features, valuable, great, perfect. And for that buyer, probably exactly the right move, exactly the right thing. Let's go over to Gucci. You're going to see poetic, colorful language that is inspirational, that talks about heritage, that talks about hearkening back to the legacy of, these are things where you can't picture the product reading the sentence. You don't know what this thing looks like. The features help you picture the product. But the marketing language around something like a Gucci is geared towards somebody who doesn't care about those things. It's geared towards somebody who cares about the inspirational experience, the experiential aspect that they value in owning this thing. It taps much more into the emotional and social threads. These are good things. Walmart has been intentional about how they're going to position their thing. Look, we're not going to start from a place of the inspirational heritage of our $13 backpack. They're not going to do that. They're going to say, look, you came here looking for a backpack? Here, this one's pretty good. Solves all these problems for you. Gucci, not going to start with, it's about this big and about that wide, and it's got a zipper that does this. They're not going to do that. Instead, they're going to make you feel really excited about the opportunity. That's intentional. A lot of small businesses, especially, are not intentional about those things. They'll come with a space of, look, it does this thing pretty well, it's about this big, it's going to cost about this much. And that could be the least interesting thing to your most valuable or most likely customer. And if you ignore that and you're not able to think about that emotional aspect, especially the social and especially the emotional, then you might be missing out on ways that you could connect more deeply to that consumer. As a consumer, I hope now that you've got a little bit more self-awareness. What do you value most? Functionality is most likely, not all the time, it's not a generalization, but most likely the least interesting thing to you. When you can acknowledge that about yourself and say, does it check these basic boxes? It does. Cool. Then I'm going to get into the thing that makes me feel excited about buying or owning or using this product. Or I'm going to avoid the thing that makes me feel kind of silly using this among my peers or my friends or my coworkers. Or I'm going to use the thing that makes me feel like everybody's eyes are on me in the right kind of way. When you just know this about yourself, now you can make smarter business decisions and you can answer the question, why would you buy that?
Thank you so much for watching. Subscribe and comment on Transmissions from Not Really Rocket Science. Learn more at notreallyrocketscience.com.